So today we will look at the principles of software engineering, another very major area of research in both computer science and management. Why is this relevant? It's because you will now be embarking on course projects. And a project is not an activity of the kind that you normally do in labs or the programming that you do in exams or while solving problems. A project is a much larger affair, is to be done by a team of people and offers possibilities for you to create an absolute industry grade software product on whatever small thing that you take up. We believe that it's an important part of learning. Therefore, CS101 always has a course project. You will recall that in our distribution of marks, as many as 35 marks are reserved for the project activity. So that activity will now start, and as a precursor, we will look at the notion of software engineering. I will then describe the course projects, what activities are to be carried out, evaluation, reporting process, and deadlines, etc. The details, of course, will be put up next week, because during the next week, you have to do basically a selection of the project and finalize initial distribution of activities between team members. I will describe the project evaluation briefly. I have not stated here, but there are two very important announcements. One related to makeup assignment labs, and the other related to makeup mid-sem test, because the mid-sem examination has left a whole lot of people bruised. They have got very low marks as compared to what they should get. And traditionally, whenever this happens, I offer a makeup test. So I will describe how that makeup test will be conducted. It will be conducted 1 week. So first, what do we mean by software engineering? You would have heard of various engineering disciplines, mechanical engineering, electrical engineering, computer science engineering, computer engineering, all kinds of things. When you apply engineering to the process of program development, it is called software engineering, essentially. We will see what are the various activities. Whenever you undertake any activity, which is a composite activity combining a lot of people and efforts, there is a very significant component of proper management techniques and methods that need to be followed. Otherwise, it may end up in a chaos. So we will see what are those processes. Those processes have been defined quite some time ago, when it was abundantly clear that the software is gaining in size. You remember we had talked about LOC or lines of code. So we are not talking about a 100-line program. We are not talking about a 1,000-line programming system. We are talking about a 50,000-line programming system as a slightly non-trivial system. We are talking about 100,000 lines of code to 500,000 lines of code as a respectable software system. And we are talking about millions of lines of code as a respectable large system. And many of you may be participating in development of these systems, design of these systems, and coding of these systems. And rest of you will be participating in getting such system developed for your own work in whichever field you are. Therefore, these systems have become an integral part of every professional's life. And it is necessary to understand how these processes are defined and how they have matured over the years. We will not discuss the ER model. I will leave it for some later discussion. But I will describe what the functional models are, what are the user interface issues, and more specifically, a document which is key to the software writing, actually, called the Software Requirement Specification Document, or SRS document. So far, whenever you see a problem, you start writing programs. I had hinted to you that you must do some thinking, some paperwork before you start writing a program. In professional projects, not a single line of code is written. If it is a till, the entire analysis and design work is completed, not a single line of code. Coding actually constitutes roughly 10 to 15% of the total activity of the software development effort. Obviously, your job is primarily to learn programming techniques. So you will not do 85 to 90% of other work. You will do a large amount of programming work. But you must get a glimpse of what these things are. So let us look at the role of software. First of all, there is a classical characterization of software. System software and application software were the two major classifications. We shall briefly see what each of these are. Additionally, there is an emerging classification for two more things. One, embedded systems, and the second is web applications. The system software, as it is called, comprises primarily of all the software which relates to management of the computer system. So it does not do anything else except manages this system and permits programmers to exploit the features of that system. Therefore, even a programming language compiler is actually a system software, because programming language compiler does not solve a real life problem. It does not, for example, balance your accounts, or it does not add marks or find averages. It does not do any application. But without a compiler, it will be almost impossible for you to write programs easily which will do all these things. So therefore, that is considered part of the system software. So you have the operating system, you have the standard third generation programming languages, as they are called, C, C++, COBOL, Fortran, Pascal, what have you, Java. There are additional developments, and these developments, by the way, the generations of programming languages typically define the level of abstraction that is available to you as a power of expression. You could write programs in machine language, but you will take 1,000 lines to write what you can write in 5 lines in C++. In exactly the same fashion, what it may take, say 500 lines to write in C++, can be written in 10 lines of SQL, or structured query language, which is one of the fourth generation languages. We shall see a glimpse of one fourth generation scripting language called awk at a later time in the class. So all these are called rapid application development tool. Please understand that for writing so many lines of code, so much time will be required. Now if you have to write millions of lines of code, you can't take hundreds of years. You still want to do that project very quickly as possible. And not every activity can be distributed amongst large number of people. So the total efforts required to develop software has also to be affordable and has to be limited. And therefore, you need tools which will permit you to do development faster. And these tools to build software keep evolving. All of these get classified as system software. So in a nutshell, the operating system, all the tools that come with the operating system and the utilities that come with the operating system, all language compilers, and any additional tools which help you to develop software faster. All of these is system software. Naturally, you and I don't write them. Typical computer science people who actually specialize in writing this kind of software would end up doing that. One advantage of system software is one group writes it, and thousands upon thousands of other application programmers can use this. As all of you are using Ubuntu, none of us has written Ubuntu. Somebody developed Ubuntu, somebody developed Linux, somebody developed GCC or C compiler, and thousands upon thousands of people can use that. So in a sense, after that development, system software becomes a manufactured product. You just put it on CDs and keep distributing it, and anybody can use it. It is not so, unfortunately, with the application software, which determines business functionality. You'll recall, for example, from the mid-sem exam paper, where you have to maintain some information about banks' accounts. Now that is only a very, very small part of what banks do. The functionality that the banks provide is enormous. You go for a car loan or a home loan, there's a loan processing. You can put fixed deposit amount, you will get interest. Interest will have to be calculated. Literally millions of lines of code goes into what we call a core banking system today. Some of the most popular core banking systems, earlier they were all coming from the West, but today two Indian products are known all over the world for their acumen in solving business problems in bank. One is called Finacle, which comes from Infosys, and the other is called iFlex, which is now part of Oracle. Oracle acquired that company. Infosys, of course, is not available for sale, luckily, so it continues to be an Indian product. This is just one example that I gave, but you take any information that is you are familiar with, say student information system. Okay. You have seen the ASC website, that is where you register, your records are maintained. How are records maintained? How, when I search for CS 101, I get the complete list of all students. how if you search for your roll number, you will get your registration details. You can update, modify, and updated and modified information becomes available to everybody. So somebody like you has written these programs, and they have become part and parcel of the operational activity. There are larger systems such as railway reservation, core banking I mentioned. There are also computational systems of very, very large magnitude in terms of lines of code. So simulators, for example. You would have heard of flight simulators. You would have played games with flight simulators. In fact, gaming software is another very, very interesting aspect of application. But there are equation solvers. There are, you would have heard of genome sequencing, the huge effort that is required to do human genome sequencing. And that is a large computational system developed by several teams working across several countries together for many years. But today it is possible to do some sequencing, some significant sequencing in a few hours by deploying supercomputers. Just by putting a supercomputer, problems don't get solved. Somebody has to write programs which work, which don't bomb when you write fgets and the file ends and you still keep getting whatever funny things. Such things cannot happen in real life system. A typical life cycle of an application software is anywhere between 10 to 25 years, typically 15 years. Why do you have to get rid of any software after 15 years? Once written, it should continue to run. Any reason why your program should not run after 15 years? Sorry? Come again? Better programs come up. While that may be true for system software, better compilers may come up. But suppose a bank has developed a banking application, or ASC has developed students processing, which is very peculiar to IIT Bombay. How will a better students information processing program come up on its own somewhere? Who will write programs which are required for his or her organization? That organization only. And that is the difference between system software and application software. Application software is invariably handcrafted for a particular requirement. And only that group will do that requirement. Even when I spoke of banking systems such as Finacle, it is not true that Infosys writes that software and every bank uses it exactly as it is. It is not true at all. Every bank has different processes internally. So that software gets customized. That customization may require 2 years, 2.5 years of effort. And after that, the software which runs in Bank of India is different from the one which runs in Punjab National Bank, is different from one which runs in Bank of Baroda, although all three of them use exactly the same code. But these modifications are done, which are bank-specific, by the bank's IT staff and associated consulting organizations such as TCS, HP, whatever. In such cases, the observation that better programs will come up is not entirely correct. It's not entirely wrong also. Better programs will not come up as a replacement of everything. But better programs will come up continuously. And why? Because I have some programs. I add business functionality, new business functionality. I have to write more programs. Some programs were doing certain things in a certain way. When better programming techniques come, people would say, I could improve the efficiency of this program, so I would write a better program. But that better program will come as a part of the maintenance activity of the current software. What happens is that over a period of 10 years or 15 years, these modifications or additions which are made to an existing software system become larger than the original system. And many times ad hocism creeps in. Somebody says, I quickly need this report. So somebody writes in this schema, this whatever, files, this thing, that thing, whatever. And then somebody else modifies it. And people change jobs. So you have written a program which is 5 years later, I look at it, and I am required to modify to include functionality. Typically, you know what happens in such cases? Because I am also a good programmer. I presume that you must have been a bad programmer if that program doesn't work proper. So I tend to rewrite most of it again. But since your program is working, I leave it alone. So the software size increases with two different components doing the same thing being present. This happens in large software. So therefore, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years later, an application software becomes more difficult to maintain, to continue to use. And that's the reason why you say enough is enough, I will rewrite the whole system. There are other reasons also. It is not in terms of better programs, but better system software, better hardware, and better programming languages may come up. To give you an example, the same banking systems were implemented in the decades of 60s and 70s using a programming language called COBOL. It was a third generation programming language. Large systems were developed because banks have been computerized for decades. What happened is that relational database, a completely new phenomena, which permitted a fourth generation programming language like SQL to be used jointly with conventional procedural programming language such as C, Fortran, whatever. People found that developing systems was much easier, and the systems that you develop were far more rugged, and therefore they decided to rewrite that software. Today, almost all of the banking software or such large business applications are written using databases SQL and some programming which could be in C++ or Java. And that some programming may be functionally doing only a little thing, but in terms of size, it is much larger than the size of the SQL code, because SQL is a fourth generation language. C, C++, Java, etc., third generation. To conclude a long story short, generally there is a life cycle, it is variable, and it is not a universal rule of thumb. It all depends upon an individual organization which is using that software. Whether at what point in time I should say I should ditch everything that I have and start doing a new thing. Please remember, start doing a new thing means roughly spending about 2 to 3 calendar years, hundreds upon hundreds of person months to rewrite that software. While you are doing that, the old software must continue to work because your business cannot stop. So it's a hard process. Embedded systems is another area which has become increasingly important ever since the electronics has permeated into appliances and gadgets. So you take today's televisions, refrigerators, washing machines, digital watches, cameras, each and every one of these has tiny computers inside. The software which drives the functionality of these gadgets, such as washing machine, washing cycles, or digital watch automatically changing the date and whatever, maintaining time, refrigerator automatically cooling, heating, whatever, not heating really, cooling to different levels. A car, which is being automatically controlled in terms of the most efficient injection of fuel into the cylinders. Since all of these computers are inside these gadgets, the software which is written for such computers is called embedded system, because the system entirely is embedded. The computer, the small minuscule operating system, everything along with the program which is permanently written, it is in read-only memories. That program is, you cannot every day load a program in your car's computer. You know. And of course, you cannot have bugs in such programs. Imagine if the car starts moving backwards when you actually want to move it forward. You cannot afford such things. So embedded systems have very special requirements. First of all, the computers are tiny, the memory is tiny, the code has to be compact. And what code I'm talking about, not the lines of code that you write as a source code for C++ or C, but the translated code. It is in this context that I had asked you a question. When you write a program, say prog1.cpp, you will see a size of that file, which is roughly the number of bytes in the source code. But when you say C++ prog1.cpp, you will get an a.out file. Have you ever wondered about the size of a.out file? Has anybody seen what is the size of a.out file? See, your curiosity ends at doing whatever is given in that sheet for the lab. Now onwards, you should be curious about this. Go and find out. Typically, if the size of your program is 1 or 2 kilobytes or 3 kilobytes, the size of the compiled program with linking with all the libraries, etc., could easily become 1 megabyte. We don't care because my computer has 64 megabytes of memory. So I don't bother. But when you embed a system inside a car to control the carburetor, then the size of memory that you have may be only 32 kilobytes. Your translated program will not fit there. So you need not only special translators, special compilers, but you also have to be careful about, you have to count every byte of the translated program. Most embedded system software people therefore develop an expertise not only in higher level programming languages, but even in the assembly language and machine language, so that they can tweak the final program.
Changes in versions are difficult.
You have sold 20,000 cars, and then the team, suppose you are part of the embedded software team, you discover, oh my God, this problem should not be solved like this. This way, the consumption of petrol is not optimum. I must add some more parameters and some calculation. You do that modification. In your labs or in general application software, what you do the modification, and you simply run that program. Even in banking software, you say, go and install it on your server. The server will run you. Now, can you say, go and install it in 20,000 cars which have already been sold? And how will you install it? The computer is not visible with RS-232 ports and a screen and a terminal and everything. It is deep inside the engine somewhere. You have to be therefore doubly careful. And there are special mechanisms of deploying these software changes into embedded systems. In fact, with the advent of wireless networks, increasingly in new embedded systems, wireless chips are being also included. And you can actually download the new version of the software automatically using wireless. Such gadgets have started coming. As you go into your professional activities, you will find more and more of them. And in fact, embedded software will become as easy to handle as your general software. The point is, going forward, embedded software will become more important than the general application software, because it will touch every aspect of human life directly, because it will be there in every household with every person. What? In a nutshell then, if such kind of software has to be written, I did not mention about the web applications, but you are familiar with web applications. In fact, any time you go to the Moodle, what you are doing is you are doing a web application. Web application is not something independent. It actually has a backend, which means it has servers which stores database files, etc., etc., and it has a front end. A front end will be there even for any other application. But for web application, the front end is usually based on a browser. And anybody having access to any browser can access that front end. So there are something special about that, and that need to be taken cognizance of. There are therefore separate tools which are available to build efficient web applications, and therefore that becomes a sort of different classification. Now, software is developed or engineered and not manufactured. That is the fundamental difference. Except for system software, which is also developed, an operating system is developed, a compiler is developed, but it can be manufactured in the sense of distribution. So you can make the compiler once and put it on a CD or put it in some file, tar file, download it, that becomes a compiler. Application software, unfortunately, very specific. Take the IIT system. The students' information management is not done by a single system which is used by all the 10 or 15 IITs. Every IIT has its own system. The only common system is joint entrance exam handling or gate exam handling systems. Those are developed jointly by these IITs. But those are not used, for example, by Mumbai University or Pune University. So this is an example in our academic community. Exactly the same is true about every company which does any kind of business. Take manufacturing. Two companies which are manufacturing certain chemicals, each one of them will have their own processes of it. There is a common package software used in manufacturing called ERP, or Enterprise Resource Planning kind of software. A big name is SAP, for example. There are several other names. But again there, just like in the core banking system, you can't use an ERP package as is. It takes years to modify it, customize it to what you require. In short then, software has to be written or engineered or developed. Now, hardware does wear out. You may have to replace the hardware. But software does not wear out. And therefore, technically, a software written even 50 years ago should even run today. As long as there are machines which can run the machine instructions of that compiled software. The only thing is, you may not be able to make changes in it, as I mentioned. It may become unmaintainable. In that sense, it wears out. Since most software is custom built, there is a limited role for packaged products, and they need customization and integration, as I said. In general, then, software development is a major activity. And the nation should be thankful for that being a major activity, because most of our foreign exchange earnings, the major lot comes from export of goods, but the second major lot, in fact, as comparable to normal exports, comes from services, mainly IT services. A large number of programmers are writing programs for maintaining, modifying, updating, or developing new systems for the whole world, because Indians have proved themselves to be very good at that task, and therefore this task has assumed greater significance of developing professional grade products which will stand scrutiny at the global level in quality. It becomes very important for us. So we define the software engineering. The software engineering is, there is a definition by IEEE. Somebody has heard of IEEE? It's an institution of electronic and electrical engineers. It's a professional society. It's a global professional society started in US. It's just like we have, for example, IET or Computer Society of India. So it's a professional society. And it develops a whole lot of such standards for usage in the industry. So there is a standard definition in 1993 which says, application of a systematic, disciplined, quantifiable approach to the development, operation, and maintenance of software. What is systematic, disciplined, and quantifiable approach? That is engineering. Engineering is not done haphazardly. When you do anything haphazardly and yet do it well, it will be called a piece of art. But when you do it methodically, there is a difference between piece of art and piece of engineering, is that piece of art is not replicable. Your art will be different than somebody else's. But engineering principles, if followed, the entire methodology is replicable. So I make a piece of equipment in my factory, as long as I have followed engineering processes, somebody else making the same piece of equipment in, say, factory in Punjab, would have identical characteristics within the tolerances. That is the beauty of engineering. So engineering is essentially analysis, design, construction, that is writing code, verification, and management of technical or social entities. This is a broad definition of engineering. When you apply that engineering to software, it becomes software. Now, any engineering has methods and processes. So what are the processes associated with software engineering? These are the various activities that we undertake when we develop software. The first and foremost is functional specification. For you, a functional specification is a question or a problem which is stated by me or someone else. So when you read a problem in the book, somebody has already specified what you have to do. In real world, such things don't happen. A functional specification by the director of an institute, for example, may be given to a company like TCS or IIT's internal team, which says, develop student information management system. Imagine you getting a question like this in an exam. What will you answer? This is nothing. It's not clear at all what you want to do. Information system is what? So you will have to struggle hard to understand exactly what is required and write it down properly. That is a major step in any real-life software engineering project. Major step. So functional specification is the first thing that you develop from a very crude definition of a problem. In this particular instant example that I gave, you say, all right, oh, you want to develop student information system, fine. So I'll ask the director, who are the people who deal with students? So the director will tell me, dean, academic programs, various faculty members, technical people in the lab, academic office clerks, and of course, students themselves. Maybe hostel coordinating unit. What I will do is, I will start meeting these people. I ask dean academic, what do you do? Then he will say something. I will ask a faculty member, what do you do? He says, I get the roll list from academic office. Then I'll go to academic office. What do you do? When students come, we ask them to fill up this form, they submit it, and then we ask them to go to hostel. Oh, there is a hostel. Who handles hostel information? Then I'll go to dean students affair. Can you not see that if I am not aware of the domain at all, then I may have to spend as much as 1 month figuring out what information is required to be maintained. And that is why software engineers automatically also become experts in various domains, all domains for which they handle information systems. They have to learn that. System engineering is actually associated with finding out which system will do what. You are developing software which will run on some servers. But other than that, there are many other things that may be required. Manual recording will be required, manual filling up of form will be required, manual filing of some information will be required. A system engineering means which part of the system does what. That at that stage a feasibility study is conducted. Is it feasible to develop software for this? Technically, of course, it is feasible. The feasibility here means affordability. How would you like if I told my director, when he says, Phatak, we have to develop the student information system, I do everything and I say, yes, it can be done. The cost will be about 23 crore rupees. He will say, thank you very much, have a cup of tea. I will maintain information by hand. So the system has to be affordable. And that is why the feasibility study is important. And affordable not only in building, but in operating also. Then you do allocation of hardware, software, people. You say, this job will be done by hardware, this job will be done by software, this job will be done by people. In your projects, you will have only two allocations. Job which will be done by your software, and job will be done by people who use that software. So users, for example, will have to feed in information. They will have to maintain some data in some text files. How will they know about it? You have to prepare a user manual. Okay, that is part and parcel of the development process. Then you do a rigorous system analysis. I will describe what are the activities that you do in analysis. Basically, you find out what data is to be handled, how it is to be handled. Then you do a system design. You think of algorithms by which you will solve those problems. And it is at this stage that the pseudocode is written for each and every algorithm. Large software, you don't write definition of design in one shot. By the way, the system analysis results in a document called Software Requirement Specification Document. Each one of you will have to write one for your project. It would easily be a 10 to 15 page document even in small projects that you will do. In real life, for large projects, a system requirement specification document often runs into 8 to 10 volumes, each of which is 500 pages big. That absolutely specifically states, for example, for student, I will capture student's roll number. Now, it's not adequate to say roll number. I will see the history of how roll numbers were maintained. Somebody tells me 9-digit roll numbers, and I take it to be true. And then when I implement the system, suddenly a fellow comes up who is still around who had an 8-digit roll number. Another person comes up, I have only a 7-digit roll number. Now, I'll say, no, you have to have 9-digit roll number, that is the rule, that is not adequate. So the analysis has to be in-depth and must cover a period of time governing that particular activity. It is at this stage that the coding starts. Coding means actually writing program. Any real-life project, if it is a one-year project, at least 3 months are spent in analysis and preliminary design. And the final design will be completed with additional 3 months period. It is only in 4 months out of that 1 year, people will be writing code. And those people who write programs, they will never interact with end users. They will have to work exactly as per the design specifications given in the document. Imagine a car manufacturing facility. A mechanic who is producing, let us say, some connecting rods or some part of the car using a lathe and something. Do you expect that mechanic to be able to go to talk to car designer every evening? No. Car designer has done the job, there are specifications, there are diagrams which have been written, engineering diagrams, there are processes which have been defined, and he is supposed to work exactly as per. A programmer actually has to do like this. And therefore, the specifications have to be crystal clear. Writing those specifications which are invariably written in a natural language is a tough task. Because natural languages permit a lot of interpretation. You write something, he reads it, he understands something else. Then he writes a more elaborate version with that something else meaning. Then I read it and I understand still something else. And finally, the poor user who talked to you, later on when he gets this software, he will say, Phatak, ye kya kya? This is not what I intended. So you can see there could be a lot of confusion, and therefore precision is highly required. It is at this stage where you do the testing, integrate various modules, and say my system is ready. Your system being ready, specified by you, is not adequate. The end user who asks you to do this job in the first place will say, let me accept it now. For acceptance, he will prepare sample data, run through various screens, run various queries, see various reports, and confirm that the system is working correct. So that is called user acceptance, and then the system will be deployed. What you see in form of student information system that is managed by ASC, for example, it has gone through all these cycles. And as we speak, modifications, etc., keep happening there. Even a modification has to go through the same cycle, albeit small. So somebody says the CPI calculation rule has changed by Senate. This has to be implemented. So there will be a change request generated, which is a mini specification or problem. Then somebody will do an analysis, which means look at all the programs which calculate CPR, affect CPR. What is to be modified? So there will be an effort estimate. This may require 15 days of time by three programmers. Somebody allocates that resource. Then after 15 days, three programmers have done, rigorous testing is done. Then it is integrated with your system and again tested. And only finally then it is released. So these are the scales of time that are required when you talk of real life software. Software project management is an important aspect. Any project management, in fact, is important. Management in general is an area where Indians are traditionally weak. And that is because, not because we are incapable, we are actually quite capable, but almost all our processes as part of our upbringing have been ad hoc and individualistic. I work in a different style, she works in a different style, he works in a different style. When three of us have to work together, it takes a lot of time for us to come to a conclusion that this is the common style of work that we'll follow. And many times things are understood in mind, they are never recorded. Samajh gaya. And therefore ad hocism comes. The developed world does not work like that. Management processes are very rigorously defined, written down and followed. And these go to any extent. So let me give you, I don't know whether I shared this example with you of a manual process which a clerk in a bank is supposed to do whenever he interacts with a customer. So Professor Gayatonde happened to read a work card in one of the Indonesian banks when he had gone there, because he went there twice, and twice that fellow, two different people, did the transaction and said, thank you very much for banking with us. So he inquired with the manager and manager showed him that card. You know what that card stated, the instructions? Instruction one, take the instrument given by the customer, that is check or draft or whatever, and keep it to your right. Instruction two, keep a paperweight on it. These are written instructions. Almost all Indians will assume that to be automatic and common sense. But without that instruction, somebody will keep it to right, somebody will keep it to the left, somebody will keep it in the pocket, somebody will keep it under a register, and after 5 minutes, he will start searching for it. So errors are possible when you don't follow exact process. That is what engineering is all about. Software teams have to be formed. Coordination and communication between those teams is a big problem. You will soon discover when you are a batch of 6, 7, 8, or 9 students, conducting a single meeting with all 8 present. You'll have to do that once a week at least, even if it is for 20 minutes. But you will find that you will waste, at least in the first 2 weeks, as much as 2 hours assembling everybody for those two. Because people don't keep time. You arrange for a meeting at 8:30 sharp in, let's say, hostel number 4 lobby. At 8:30 sharp, probably only one person who stays in the room closest to that lobby appears. Nobody else appears. We are very discourteous to our colleagues in any team. Let me tell you that. This is one instance, this is one opportunity where you learn the meaning of discipline. And not for somebody else, for your own sake. So these are the things that you need to learn. Communication. How do you communicate quickly? Emails. You will have to have an absolute compulsion of reading emails at least twice a day if you are doing a project. At least twice a day. Otherwise, communication and coordination will not happen. The software project management is often based on lines of code, which, and an analysis measure says function point analysis. We'll not go into the details of that. Roughly what it means is, larger the size of the project, larger will be the number of people required, at least during those activities which can be done parallel. But analysis and design has to be done by a few minds. So even if you have 6 or 7 people in the team, it is best to get just those 2 or 3 who can think about larger issues and who are good in crystal clear thinking and writing down. Those are the people who should do analysis and design. There's nothing wrong if I cannot be as good as you, for example, in this. I should accept it. If you are better, better you do it. Because if I do it, I'll chew up the whole project. Of course, there should be inputs from every member of the team, because all of you have to understand how this process runs. there are specific models to measure process maturity. The most significant model which has been adopted by the whole world has come out of a software engineering institute. This was developed many, many years ago in Carnegie Mellon University. The Carnegie Mellon Software Engineering Institution is very famous. They have developed a model for called capability maturity model. See, different people have certain capabilities, and these capabilities mature as they do more and more projects. And this maturity then results. Now, this capability maturity model has been constructed at several levels. And depending upon which company or which group of professionals is at what level, a number is given. So somebody has level 1, somebody has level 2, somebody has level 3, somebody has level 4, 5 is the highest level. Emerging out of this, there are various other models that have been prescribed for different aspects of software development process. So they are called CMMI, etc., etc. I'll not go into those details. But every group is always at some level or the other. You will be glad to know that amongst the first companies which achieved CMM level 5 were Indian companies. Way back, the maximum number of software development companies in the world which are at CMM level 5 exists in India. It's a matter of pride for us. So it is not just the minor work that is being done by Indian companies for the world. It is absolutely top class work. When you do your projects, you will be learning to get somewhere. Generally, you will be described to be at CMM level 1 when you start. So understand what is CMM level 1. CMM level 1, which is called the initial level, processes is ad hoc, even chaotic. Very few processes are defined. You won't even define how to conduct a meeting. You won't define how to write minutes. You won't define what documentation is to be written in which style. You will learn soon to define that, some of which I will help you by giving you sample definitions. But then to adapt to these definitions, to imbibe these definitions and to follow those definitions, that is what is following process. So success depends entirely on individual efforts. And this is the worst model, this is the level 1 model. I will not describe level 2, level 3, level 4, level 5. Those of you who are interested, this is general knowledge on the web. You can go to web and ask for CMM level. You'll find out how these are refined. Unfortunately, we have categorized this whole study as a part of management study. And since management is not engineering, it is not in our syllabus. And therefore, we don't study. That is nonsense and the biggest myth. Each one of us has to study whatever is required, whether it is management, whether it is biology, whether it is science, whether it is economics, or whether it is software. So you will have to learn everything about something, and this gives you a chance to do that. The classical system analysis, this understands the software requirement, what functions your program or software is supposed to handle, and then you specify that functionality, you specify interfaces. Interfaces means there is a module which collects data from users and puts it in a database file. There is another module which accesses data and updates it. The first module is supposed to do verification of data and put it there. Now, obviously, suppose you write the second program, I write the first program, both of us must agree on the common definition of this database file. Otherwise, what will I write and what will you read will not match. This is one example of an interface between two separate software modules. Your entire system may have to interact with something else. You like write a system for collecting fines from students for library. But the library enrollment itself happens somewhere else. So they will give you an enrollment file. You must understand what is the format of the file, because your system will have to read that file and take the data in. So these interface definitions become very critical. Rules which govern the values of data and rules which govern the processing logic. As I gave you an example, CPI calculation has to be done exactly as CNET has specified, not otherwise. During the system analysis is something that you will be doing in the first phase after deciding on your project. You will model, first of all, this is after you have written the functional specification of the system. What is it supposed to do? You might develop a game of sticks and ladders. You might develop a project for finding out various, solving Diophantine equations. You might do a variety of things. I will come to how you will select your projects. But having selected a project, you have to define what functionality it will do. And then you have to say, all right, once this functionality is implemented, how will anybody use it? So there will be capturing and validation of input. There will be queries that people would like to make to your system. Suppose you write an examination result processing system. Now somebody has to enter data, somebody has to query. Like you query on ASC, you'll have to build such facilities in your system. So you have to model reports. There could be special interfaces. Embedded systems will have interfaces which could be even electronic interface. A signal is coming from a sensor in a factory, an electronic signal. You have to actually capture it, sample it, read it, and act accordingly. So the processing requires interface to an electronic signal. These are special things. So these are a variety of things that are part and parcel of the system analysis work. An SRS document that you will write will generally contain an introduction. It will contain the problem definition for your project. Will contain detailed functional specification. Then it will contain description of data input and output. Any user interfaces that you will have to build, what kind of screens, etc. Interfaces to other systems, if any, which will generally not be there. But at least one interface will be there, namely the deployment of your entire software. What is the directory structure? Suppose I take your project from your computer and load it on my computer. Will it work exactly as it is? It may not, because you might have certain files in some directories which may not exist in my machine. So all of this actually becomes an interface to the operating system or interface to the computer system. What is the acceptance criteria? When will someone else say you have completed your job as you yourself described it? And finally, there could be appendices containing details. You will be doing only a glimpse of this kind of thing. As I said, you won't be writing 5,000 lines of specification in 10 volumes. But you, those 15 pages that you will write, you will find that it will take at least several hours of effort with editing, reviewing, writing, etc. It's not an exam paper that you write where the teacher is implicitly supposed to understand whatever you have written in English. This is something which is going to be read by someone else. And the design is going to be based entirely on that document, nothing outside it. So documentation becomes a very, very critical part of this effort. These course projects offer you a chance of doing something realistic. First, an opportunity to develop industry-grade project. Currently, when you open a file, you assume file has opened. When you read data, you assume that it is correct. That is because those are the examples that you are solving. And that was necessary because you are learning the basics of programming. Now you are learning the basics of industry-grade software. Nothing can be assumed. Anything can go wrong has to be the only assumption. And anything going wrong has to be guarded against. If a program has to work with correct input guaranteed, it may take, let's say, 100 lines to do some functionality. But if a program has to work, even if absolutely absurd data values are given, and yet the program should not bomb, and yet the program should process whatever correct data you get and point out errors wherever the data is not correct, then the program becomes 500 lines instead of 100 lines. 400 of those lines have to be written by you to validate this, do this, give an error report, put this in this file, put that in that file. That's the donkey work that you'll have to do to make a program industry grade. These projects are open-ended projects, so what you have to do is not necessarily well-defined. Obviously, you have to work in the constraints of this being one course out of several courses that you are doing this semester. And we have hardly 1.5 months left. So that is why the activity that you will do will be loosely defined, but you will have to define it in the first 2 weeks, from next week and next to next week. Teamwork will be very important, and therefore efforts must be contributed by every student. There will be two-stage submission and evaluation process. Stage one will have problem definition and the analysis and design of the algorithm. You may include sample code if you have written it just for the trial basis, but no actual coding is expected to be done in this stage at all. Like professionals don't write a single line of program unless they have completed these activities. And you will submit an SRS document with a draft user manual. Why draft user manual? Later on when you write programs and test them,
you yourself may find out that this activity may be done better by user in this fashion, so you may change some part of the user manual. In stage two, of course, you will do complete implementation, write the code, the complete code, explanation, final documentation, everything. This is what the two-stage process would be. Efforts must be made by each individual member, which will naturally go into the evaluation. I will tell you more about evaluation in a short while. In this, you should learn the basic principles of project management. Believe me, if something remains with you as most important in your entire career, it is more likely to be the project management that you discover and learn in the process of doing this project. It is at least as important as any other technical knowledge that you will gather from this place, because that is what will decide whether you successfully, competently, and in time and in cost can manage to do your professional activities later on in life. People, many people you would have seen, they do a management degree after completing their engineering because they suddenly realize they don't understand those processes. This is your first chance to learn these things, better learn it well. You will learn professional programming style, you will learn to work together in groups towards a common goal, you will learn to discuss, you will learn to design, you will learn to document, you will learn to review. None of these things you have done so far in a programming course. So far you have learned programming. Most importantly, you will learn to take decisions and you will learn to meet deadlines. So deadlines are not only for assignments in an academic program. Deadlines are there in the world everywhere. Coordination. So here is a stipulation. A lab batch will work on an allocated programming project and your batch TA will be your mentor for the project. Of course, there could be additional mentors. For example, in every lab, we have some senior TAs around. In case of any problem that you and your TA jointly face, you're most welcome to talk to your senior TA. There will be another group of consultants which I will make available, and I'll personally be available for occasional discussion. But each batch should divide this into multiple teams. It is left to your TA and yourself, but it is best done. So if you are a 6-people batch, divide into groups of teams of 3. If you are an 8-people batch, maybe groups of 4. There are 9-people batch, maybe 3-3 and something, whatever. You can take a call on this, but larger the team, the more difficult it is for the team members to meet, discuss, decide, and so on. Each team should have a team leader, sort of. You nominate amongst yourselves, and the team leaders of as many teams as you have in the batch will automatically become coordinators for the whole project jointly. The regular meetings and discussions have to happen. For the first time, I'm making lab attendance compulsory now. Observe that when you are being evaluated through lab assignments, I did not insist on compulsion. But here it is compulsory. Why? Because I am not sure that the additional meeting per week that is slated will happen correctly and precisely, at least in the first 2 weeks, till you fathom out the coordination issues. Till you fathom out that people have to come sharp at that particular time to meet and discuss. So till you do such time, the lab attendance will be compulsory. Because some discipline has to be forced on us to be followed in a group project of this sector. How many of you write diaries? Very few. Majority of people don't write. It's again another Indian problem, we don't write diaries. And that is why most of our history has been written by others. If we wrote diaries, we would have been documenting history. Whatever you do elsewhere, for this course project, diaries have to be maintained. There's no choice. I will describe the diary format. For the next week, the diary will only contain the discussions that you had for the selection of the project. But from next week after that, when you actually start working, of course, those of you who are interested can start maintaining project diaries from now. What we need to capture is how many minutes or hours I spent on a certain activity on a daily basis. On a certain day, I may do 0 thing about a project. Against that day, the entry will be 000. On a certain day, I may spend only 15 minutes discussing with one person certain issue. Both our diaries should have 15 minutes under discussion and the name of the person that we participated in. There cannot be any verbal discussion unless there is at least one line recorded somewhere about that discussion, which is called minutes of the discussion. These may appear trivial, but very important process of management. Some of the nature of the work that is described here, I'll give you the exact quantification. Most probably these will be the thing. Discussions, design, programming, testing, documentation or report writing, and any logistics. And if you do anything else about the project which is not covered, you cover it under miscellaneous. What is the advantage? At the end of the project, if you are a 7-member team, for example, and each member has this diary, by adding up or summing up the total number of minutes or hours that are spent under each activity by each student, you will get to know what is the total amount of person days effort that you have spent on this project. Out of that, you take out the effort spent on actual programming, and then you will realize what I am saying, that programming will constitute only a small percentage of the total effort when you are building an industry-grade system. But I want you to learn it for yourself. And of course, that quantification is essential because marks would be given not only on the quality and the quantitative nature of the programs that you have written, but the efforts that have been put in by. So each student will maintain a project diary which will have daily entries. I'll notify the format. And consolidated entries are to be uploaded every week. It's a modification from last year I'm doing, where last year I had said that you will submit your diaries with your final submission. And I got beautiful diaries, very nicely constructed. They're so beautifully constructed that they must have been hypothetical. Now, we don't want that because I don't benefit from those diaries. Neither do you. You might get 1 mark more or 1 mark less here, but you don't learn anything if you do that. So fudging is useless. You have to learn, and therefore you must maintain these diaries. So these diaries must be maintained every day by the student, and the consolidated entries for a week must be uploaded for the entire team. I will describe the formats for this. Submission schedule, I will notify it on the Moodle. There will be weekly diary submissions. There will be stage-wise submission schedule, and of course, stage-wise evaluation. I will describe all of this in the Moodle. One important part of this evaluation which I wanted to discuss with you is that out of 35 marks, 10 marks are to be awarded by yourselves. 10 marks are to be awarded by yourself. 25 marks will be awarded based on the project reports, the quality of the project, the quantitative nature of the project, and the viva that will be conducted for the whole group. So these marks for the project will be awarded for the group. Let's say I am a member of group, say 331. So if the group gets, let us say, 21 out of 25, then I will also get 21 out of 25. Each member of the team gets 21 out of 20. If the group gets 17, I'll get 17. If the whole group gets 0, I get 0, no matter how much I have worked. If the group gets 25, even if I have been a sleeping partner, I will still get 25. That is the advantage of being part of a group. You swim or sing as part of the group. But the individual efforts must also be factored into. Who knows how much individual efforts have been put in? I know my efforts best. Nobody else does. But I need to record it because there is an evaluation. That is why I must maintain diary. Second, I can say that out of 10 marks, I deserve 8 marks. But I must be able to convince my peers that I do deserve 8 marks. That is why the process will be at every stage, you will allocate marks out of 5. At the end of the stage, there will be a peer review meeting of the lab batch. And the batch members will discuss these individual marks. And at the end of the review, you have to convince and be convinced that the final marks are correct reflection. I had introduced this last year and it worked very successfully. I have had instances where somebody was given 0 marks and that person admitted that he deserves 0 because he did not do anything in the project. You see, you can fool me during a viva by going to a friend previous night and saying, kya kya kiya batao, and then vomit out something and I say, okay, reasonably good, 3 out of 5. But I cannot convince you when I sit in the peer group. You will say, kyo be lallu kab aaya tha? You never showed up. And therefore, convincing your peer group is very difficult. I also want you to learn something very important in life from this process. Rest of your life, you will actually end up continuing to do self-evaluation and continuing yourself to prove to your peers. There won't be any exams and marks in life. And this, therefore, is an important attribute of life. I hope you learn it. I have found it to be most successful event. However, there are always some temptations at the individual level. So suppose I say, अरे यार पांच में से पांच दे देता हूँ क्या होगा? And suppose the members are all my friends, I say, please, I am not doing well elsewhere, 5 marks मिले. And suppose you say yes, then there is a counter, it's called Fatak's counter strategy, which says, I will randomly sample a student from every batch, and I will conduct a rigorous viva. If during that viva I find a discrepancy in the efforts and contribution and the marks given, then the marks will be reduced. Suppose I have given myself 5 out of 5 and I am vivaed in this fashion, and that viva results in me getting 1 out of 5. 4 marks will be deducted from every member of that team for not conducting the peer review process professionally. Now this is a random thing, so you may presume that I may not catch upon such a random person. But that's a risk you have to take. So you'll also learn risk taking. Whether to take risk or whether not to take risk. My sincere advice to you is, please don't take risk. I've been teaching here for 40 years. I'm generally very good at sampling. I think I will leave it at that. All right, happy programming. Thank you.